Hi, my name is Jake McConnell. I've been living in Chicago since the end of August, but I'm a native Illinoisan. I've lived here since I was born for 19 years of my life.
So, Jake, you came across a certain phenomenon in Chicago?
You could say it was a certain phenomenon. It was probably about 3 in the morning. I was going for a walk like I usually do. And I just decided I was going to walk north. So I walked north until something happened. And I'm walking and the shadow leaps out of the darkness at me and sprays something on my shoes. I'm like, what the hell's going on? So the figure pulls me over to like this little like alley kind of thing. And there's like foam on my shoe. And he starts like scrubbing them and washing them, and he's like saying, "I'm the shoe shine king. I'm the best one in this damn town." And like I it was just so fast, I couldn't even react. I was just blown away what was happening. And he finished washing my shoes. He did a good job, and he's like $8, and I'm like, "What?" He's like $8. I'm like, "I don't even have money," and I scrounged up like $3 in my pocket. That's all I had. And he got pissed and he ran away. Definitely. Strange thing.
Do you know where it was?
It's the street that's right in front of the Art Institute Museum.
Alright. And what time was it when it happened?
Like 3 in the morning.
3 in the morning, so yeah. You think he'll show up if we go there?
Possibly.
Possible.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure he works this area. He probably gets enough money because he buys new cleaning products.
Can you describe what he looks like?
He was black, really short. He was older too, probably like in his 50s or so. It was long, I can't really remember too well what facially it looked like. But I think it was colder too because he was wearing a lot of clothes.
You said you have a poem to go with this?
Yeah, he said some great lines, so I decided to, I wrote a poem based off what he said to me. So this is a poem through his perspective. I'm the shoeshine king, best one around in this goddamn town. Now come on, my brother, it'll only cost you $8. You see, I know all those pretty ladies down the street, and I could hook you right up, my friend. I've been playing this tune for 20-something years, wiping away a whole lot of dirt and tears. These streets, I know they look suspiciously empty, like a poor man's grave, but I swear I am not a criminal, I'm not depraved. I'm just stuck in a bad situation and I can't get out. My soul escapes, I want to go somewhere, I want to be successful, I always want to try, but I can't help it, I hear spirits in the rye. I didn't mean to throw my brother in that pit. They said they would pay me $20 for him. You look like you got some money. You're not from around here. Cause no one wears a striped suit in Adelmar. Place that leather shoe right here. I'll shine those heels right up. I'm the shoe shine king. I'm not a criminal. I'm not depraved. I'm just a hard working man. Thank you. So that's my little poem.
So how many of those words did he actually say?
Some of the lines like, I'm the shoeshine king, best one around this goddamn town. I'll cost you $8. And then when I mentioned that I live in this building, he was talking about how he knows there's lots of pretty ladies around here that he could hook me up with. I forgot to mention that. So that was all from him I got. He also said when he first approached me, the first thing he said was, "I'm not a criminal." So things like that, little bits and pieces I took from the Dead Sea Scrolls version of the Bible, mixed them into here. It's kind of a hobbled together thing.
So you've been living in Illinois for...
whole life.
Have you ever heard like weird stories about Chicago?
Oh, of course. I mean, even out where I'm from, the suburbs, you know, there's this whole Nighthawks phenomena. It's this whole underbelly of America that you don't really hear about unless you are from America. It's things like David Lynch's Blue Velvet and, like, movies like that really kind of show this, like, underbelly of, like, homeless people and people that stay up all night long and truckers, murderers, junkies. That's kind of the world I'm from. I'm one of those types of people that you see in a diner at 2 in the morning. You know, like that painting Nighthawks.
Yeah.
So I'm kind of from that world. So I've always been around. I've always had crazy situations, even in my hometown. Crazy conspiracy theories, always stuff like that. So I'm used to it. But I've definitely heard always crazy things about Chicago. I mean, it's a city, so it's that intensified.
What do you think, like, people are attracted to the darkness? What do you think, like, what is it that attracts these phenomenal, strange, not normal people?
I mean, for me, it's like, I'm always, I always like the darker side of life. It's more beautiful, it's more attractive to me. I don't like happy things, I find it very boring, but, like, depressing, sad things are always more interesting. And I think, like, the people that come out at night, you know, you never go to a diner at 2 in the morning, and, you know, people are never smiling. They're always sullen or, like, depressed looking. They're there for a reason. I think it's because, like, I don't know, the night, it just attracts, like, the weirder type. I think it's, you can almost hide in the darkness. Almost like they're the freaks of society. They come out at night like vampires or something.
I keep going.
I mean, actually, right now I'm writing a whole thesis on those types of people that come out at night. And it's just, it's kind of like, you know, in Dracula where he says, you know, listen to the children of the night, how you can hear them sing. It's kind of like that, you know, there's this daylight image of America where it's bright and bustling, your dreams come true. But, like, a lot of people don't understand that the American dream is actually a nightmare. Like, there's this scary underside to it. Like, every town has a really, like, dark side. Like, Crystal Lake, where I'm from. Crystal Lake, it sounds so nice and pretty. And if you go out there during the day, it's fantastic, cute little cliche American suburb. You know, little shops and old people and everything. But then there's a flip side to my hometown where there's middle schoolers doing heroin and dying and killing themselves. Just, I was talking to you previously, just today on the news, there was a hate crime committed by an eighth grader. I mean, there's definitely a dark underside to every little town too. And I think that's something that's really, really truly American, is that we're almost like, I like to call it like the American werewolf. You know, during the day, it's really nice, a businessman, but at night it's this howling monster. I really think that's what America can be summed up as, the werewolf.
You think there's something about the night that changes people? You know, like in American Psycho, you see this guy, he's totally normal during the day, but a monster at night.
I mean, I definitely think at night there's definitely a different atmosphere. Like, where I love to go to in Crystal Lake is Country Donuts. It's a 24-hour diner. There during the day, it's like bustling and busy, like 7 in the morning, it's jam-packed, every seat's taken up, there's people going to work, buying coffee, buying donuts, it's really busy and bustling. But like at 3 in the morning, it's like a David Lynch movie, there's like maybe one or two people and it's like quiet. And like the only noise is the compressor from them making fresh donuts and the top classic rock station playing. So the night definitely gives things a different feel. Like even look outside, like, during the day, it's busy, there's people walking down the street, the train's going by, but right now there's nothing, just the eerie lights and the fog rising. It definitely alters the mood that things are in.
You told me this one story how you were with your girlfriend one night, and suddenly a person came up to you. Can you tell that story?
Yeah, that was with my ex-girlfriend. We were in Grand Park at night, and we were just sitting there in Grand Park talking and stuff, and this lady hobbles up to us, and she reeks of, like, alcohol, and she just sits down next to us and starts saying, call 911, call 911, call 911. And, like, we have no idea what's going on. So my ex, she starts calling 911, and this lady, she seems like maybe she's a little bit mentally disabled, too. So she starts calling 911, and this guy comes up to us, and he starts handing her a purse, and she starts kicking the guy. And the guy just says to me, I don't know what her problem is, man. Some kid's tried taking her purse. she's been drinking a lot, and then he just disappears. So, you know, my friend, she calls 911. She talks on the phone with 911, the crazy lady, and the crazy lady is saying, I want to go home. I feel sick. Call 911. So then my friend, she goes and waits in the street for the ambulance and the police to show up. And so I'm left sitting next to this lady, and she'd say, call 911. And I'd say, well, I already did. And she would say, no, you didn't. And I'd say, yes, I did. And she'd say, I don't know you. So I introduced myself, I'm Jake. And then she'd just repeat the same thing over and over again. And so eventually she started walking away, and I walked her to the street. And the ambulance, they strapped her in a stretcher and shoved her in the van and said, okay, we're going to take her to detox. This kind of thing happens every night. Thanks for calling. And they didn't even take her name or anything, and then they were gone.
So a lot of people, like, are scared at night. Are you, like, afraid traveling alone in Chicago?
I mean, I look like this. I'm told I'm pretty scary looking. So I personally am not afraid of other people. I mean, I'd imagine if you were a young girl, a very young, pretty girl walking on the street, I'd be terrified. But, like, this, no one wants to bother this. So I'm personally not worried. I can understand how most people would be.
Would you ever carry a weapon on you? Or do you already?
I carry a small knife on me from time to time, but in reality, though, you'd probably... No one really knows how they're going to act in a situation, even if you do have a weapon on you. Like, if some guy jumps at you and points a gun at the back of your head, you're not going to think, oh, I have a knife, I could attack him. You're going to probably shit your pants or something.
Yeah. But you're more safer during the day than you are at night.
That is true, I'd like to imagine.
What do you think that is?
Like I said, the world runs in a day culture, so traditionally more people are out during the day. There's people all over the place. That's just the only reason why.
Anything you want to add?
Well, speaking of night, there is, if you look this up, statistically speaking, there is more 911 calls made during a full moon than during any other moon phases. Like, there's this whole thing that the full moon makes people act a bit crazy and weird, which is statistically true.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think a definitely good place, look for people out at night would be Country Donuts, Dunkin' Donuts down the street.
Yeah. Okay, so if you're traveling at night, where are some places you should not visit if you're by yourself?
I'd stay away from alleys or areas which are known to have gangs. I mean, I would never go to the south side by myself at night. places like that. I mean, I'm relatively safe when I just walk the main streets. Or parks at night, that can be a bit sketchy too. A lot of homeless people sleep there at night. Places like that, they are kind of farther away from the big buildings.
What about like places like the CTA and the buses?
Again, with CTA, I think you're relatively safe, in my opinion, because there's cameras and there's monitors and stuff. I think the bus is pretty safe too, because you're not that far from the bus driver. But I mean, crazy things happen, like on the, a few years ago, on one of those Greyhound buses that go cross country.
Yep.
This schizophrenic guy was sitting next to this guy who was asleep, and he just started stabbing him in the throat, and eventually severed his head, and held it up, and everybody ran off the bus. I mean, it's not impossible for something like that to happen. Just uncommon.
Would you ever, in your lifetime, were you ever afraid of the dark?
No, I've never been afraid of the dark. When I was 5, I watched horror movies that really kind of desensitized me. But I mean, the whole thing about being afraid of the dark goes back to our evolutionary roots, where we were monkeys, and we were afraid to go out in the dark because big things like cats lived in the dark and came out that time and ate you if you went out there. So that's where that stems from, but... I mean, living in Chicago, there's really no such thing as dark because you have all these lights. You never ever see true darkness. Like, you couldn't see the stars right now.
Yeah.
So no, I've never really been afraid of the dark.
Do you think it's the people that make the city dangerous, or you think it's the city that attracts those certain types of people?
I think the city, it's a different thing where you can live cheaply if you find the right place. You can eat cheaply. You don't really need a car. There's public transportation, so that attracts a lot of people of lower income. And you have all these different cultures coming through because it's also like a cultural epicenter. So you have all these different things mixing and playing with each other. Well, out in the suburb, you have to be of a certain salary or income, because you have to afford a house, you have to buy a car. So in the suburbs, traditionally, everyone's from kind of like this middle area. Or in a city, you can have rich people living in the loop, thousands, millions of dollars, or you can have poor people living in the south side. So you really have this whole spectrum of economic value going on.
How do you feel like your life has changed differently from safety, from living in the suburbs compared to living in the city?
Safety-wise, I personally have had no troubles of anything, but I do find myself not walking around with my iPod or stuff like that. I do feel myself, like, I don't walk around with my laptop all day long, only where I need to take it. So I do feel that, but I think that's just something culturally that's kind of pushed on me. I personally, safety-wise, don't feel much different at all, per se.
So if you were ever walking around Chicago, you would travel in packs, right?
Yes, I'd recommend that, definitely.
Yeah, so what are some safety guides you want to give to those people?
Yeah, you're asking the wrong person. Safety guides, definitely I'd say walk in groups. Just avoid shady-looking areas. If you see a person, you know, don't judge a book by its cover, but if you see a person that looks like he's probably a guy from a gang, you know, he's wearing the gang signs and stuff, I'd say maybe avoid that person. Like I said, groups is the most important thing.
Yeah.
Don't carry lots of cash on you. Like, don't go out with like a couple hundred dollars in your pockets. That's just stupid.
What would you consider like shady? What's your definition of what shady?
That's so weird because I'm attracted to shady. People say I'm shady, but I don't think I am. I don't know, shady, something. It's hard to explain. Like, shady, for instance, I was at a restaurant where there was this big, tall bouncer guy standing by the back door, and people kept running in darker clothes, coming in back and forth through the back door carrying packages. That was shady. Stuff like that. Stuff that doesn't seem right. It makes you feel uncomfortable. Like, when you notice it right away, like, without thinking, you feel uncomfortable.
Basically, things are not normal.
Yeah, instinct, I'd have to say.
All
right. Again, I'm not normal. I'm not too normal either.
That is okay. But, yeah, a lot of people can... Most people go to sleep during the night. But what do you think causes people to stay up during the night? Like, what makes them nocturnal compared to, you know?
I don't know, I think it's more people of a like-minded set of mind. A lot of people choose to. There's people that are definitely attracted to the night like I am. There's people who are insomniacs that can't sleep. Of course. There's other people that work night jobs. Like, I have a family friend who works on buses at night. So he lives a flip-flop life. Like, he sleeps from like 6 in the morning to like 4 in the afternoon or something like that. There's, you know, like truckers, people like that who work all night long, they sleep during the day. So there's that too. Because you get good hours, because no one wants to work in the middle of the night.
Mm-hmm. So what would you say was the strangest thing you've ever seen in Chicago?
Strangest thing I've ever seen in Chicago.
Can you take a moment?
I remember when I first moved out here, it was probably around 80 degrees one day. Like, 80 degrees, really hot, sunny, middle. This wasn't at night, though. This was in the broad daylight, probably noon. There's, like, this black guy, and I swear to God, he's, like, almost 7 feet tall. just walking down a street, and he's wearing this tiny little plastic St. Patrick's Day hat on his head. And he had this crazy look on his face, and he's just walking straight like nobody's business, just wearing his tiny little green plastic St. Patrick's Day hat. That was pretty funny. Weird, though. There's a lot of weird things. I mean, there's my whole Halloween story that we got on the...
Oh, please tell.
So, the whole Halloween night, we went to a party, yada, yada, yada. We were ended up at a diner at 2 in the morning. We ate there till like 3:30, and we're waiting for the train. It's like 3:30. It's in Boys Town. And there's a bunch of transgender people in that little heat box with us. And we're talking to them. And we get on the train. We're on the last train car. And my friend, he smells the air, and he starts panicking because he feels like he's going to throw up. And then the smell hits me, and it smells like shit, like someone just, like, crapped themselves. And it was an awful smell. And we had, like, bellies full of greasy American food. So we ran through the train, through the emergency exit, swung open the second door, got into the next car. This one smelled worse than the first one. There's, like, actual, like, piss on the ground. So we ran through that one. We get into a third train car, and we can breathe. The whole time, I'm covered in white face paint, dressed up as like a voodoo priest with like a top hat and animal bones hanging off of me, and like we're all laughing hysterically, and people are just giving us the strangest looks. So definitely, there's a lot of adventures like that happen.
If you had to move out of the UC and live in apartments, where would you look, and where would you not look?
I'm looking at the Roosevelt right now, which is just down the street. It's student housing, but it's very free. You have a lot of freedom. I'm looking at that. I mean, I'd like to live in an area like maybe like Wicker Park or Boys Town. Those have nice communities there. Something like that. Or where was it? Logan Square. That's a nice area, too. I like those kind of grungy feeling alternative neighborhoods. Those are cool.
Where wouldn't you live?
I wouldn't live in the south side where you your house breaking into. There's just no point.
Yeah. And what would you do if your house got broken in? Would you call the cops or would you defend yourself?
Yeah. Wait, if it happened when I was there?
No. This is like a scenario.
Like if I was in my house and someone came in?
Yeah.
Well, I'd defend myself. But then if they didn't leave, I'd call the police. I mean, I think that's the first thing you'd do. I don't think you'd have time to call the police.
How often at night do you hear a fire truck going off?
Oh, it's just background noise. I can't even notice it anymore.
But when you first came, you were like, it happens every night, right?
No, oh, yeah, totally.
You think it was just distress calls, or
what do you think? I mean, Chicago was the murder capital for a while.
Yeah. Now it's not? What is it still?
I'm not sure. It might be second or third. Yeah. I can't remember.
They say, like, cities are always dangerous, like New York, Chicago, L.A., but suburbs, not as dangerous.
Like I said, it's just the suburbs, a lot of, you don't have a lot of that gang activity because a lot of the gang activity, I hate to discriminate, is from poorer neighborhoods. And when you're in the suburbs, you're kind of like in this middle-class neighborhood, so a lot of the gangs don't make it out that far.
So you think it's the economic value that makes the darkness much more dangerous?
Maybe. I mean, I don't want to be that person. I mean, I'm not from a... I'm from a poor economic background. I mean, I hate to discriminate, like I said, but I mean... You know, you have people growing up in generations after generations of poverty, and they see that they can't get themselves out of the ghetto, and, you know, then they steal because they want to have to take the easy way out. I mean, it's just you have generations and generations of people doing that, and this kind of problem happens. I mean, it's so hard to get out of a place when you're, like, born into that. It's almost like a caste system, you know?
Yeah.
So, I feel like maybe that's one of the main causes, though.
All right. I think that's all the questions.
All right.
All right, thanks.
You're welcome.